refreshing policy towards Pakistan from Ford to Clinton. Dr. Akhtar is also the editor of Pakistan Politico, Pakistan's first strategic and foreign affairs magazine. Dr. Akhtar is a member of Pakistan's of Prime Minister Advisory Council on Foreign Affairs. Dr. Akhtar is a non-resident senior fellow at South Asia Center Atlantic Council, Washington, D.C. Today, she will be speaking on history and evolution of nuclear program and policy in South Asia, Western perspective. Our second guest speaker for today's webinar would be Dr. Adil Sultan. Dr. Adil Sultan is currently the acting dean and head of Department of Aerospace Sciences and Security Studies at Air University, Islamabad. Previously, he has worked as Director of Nuclear and Strategic Current Affairs at Center for Aerospace and Security Studies. He works on arms control and non-proliferation, nuclear strategy and doctrines, cross-domain deterrence, deterrence stability, and nuclear confidence building measures in South Asia. He is author of the book Universalizing Nuclear Non-Proliferation Norms, a Regional Framework for South Asian Nuclear Weapon States, published by Palgrave Macmillan in 2019. He has written several books, chapters, research papers, and has contributed op-eds in leading Pakistani newspapers on issues related to national security. Dr. Sultan has served in Pakistan Air Force for over 30 years and had worked at Pakistan Strategic Plans Division for 14 years, where he was Director Arms Control and Disarmament Affairs, and later as Director Research and Analysis at Policy Doctrine and Strategy, branch of the SPD. He is former Visiting Research Fellow at War Studies Department, King's College, London, International Institute for Strategic Studies, London, and Henry L. Stimson Center, Washington, D.C. Dr. Sultan is also the co-founder of the web portal Strategic Foresight for Asia, which is London-based platform publishing policy-relevant analysis on security-related issues. He will be presenting his views on evolution of Indian nuclear program and its nuclear diplomacy historiographic perspective. Our third speaker for today's webinar would be Dr. Zafar Khan. Dr. Zafar Khan is currently an executive director of Balochistan FinTech Network, and he's a professor of international relations at Balochistan University of Information Technology, Engineering and Management Sciences, Quetta. He's also taught at the Department of Strategic Studies, National Defense University, Islamabad. His papers have appeared in various international peer-reviewed journals such as Cambridge Review of International Affairs, Comparative Strategy, Washington Quarterly, Journal of Contemporary China, Contemporary Security Policy, East Asia, and International Journal of Conflict Management. He has authored Pakistan Nuclear Policy, A Minimum Credible Deterrence in 2015, and Nuclear Deterrence in South Asia, New Technology and Challenges to Sustainable Peace in year 2020. His latest book, authored by him, entitled India's Evolving Deterrent Force Posture, Temptation for Preemptive Strikes, Power Projection and Escalation Dominance in the year 2021. Today, we'll be speaking on Pakistan's perspective on South Asian nuclear history. Our fourth speaker for today's webinar will be Dr. Toghrul Yameen. Dr. Toghrul Yameen retired as brigadier from Pakistan Army and subsequently pursued his career in academia. He is the founding member, associate dean for Center for International Peace and Stability at the National University of Sciences and Technology in Islamabad. He is also a member of Higher Education Commission of Pakistan for framing the national curriculum for peace and conflict studies. He earned his doctorate from the Department of Defense and Strategic Studies at Qadian University in Islamabad. In 2013, he was a fellow of international program of the Cooperative Monitoring Center at Sandia National University, Albuquerque, New Mexico. Dr. Yameen's academic interests include cybersecurity, strategic decision-making, arms control and non-proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, refugees and migration issues, UN peacekeeping operations, international humanitarian law, and China-Pakistan economic corridor. He's author of four books, The Evolution of Nuclear Deterrence and Its Impact on South Asian Stability, written in the year 2015, Developing Confidence Building Measures in Information Space and India and Pakistan in the year 2014, UN peacekeeping operation in Somalia from the year 1992 till 1995, a Pakistani perspective in the year 2019, and Securing Pakistan, Making Sense of the Fundamental Counterterrorism and Counterviolent Extremism in the year 2020. Today, he will be speaking on current trends in global politics of non-proliferation and South Asian perspective. Before we proceed further, I would like to mention that this webinar will be conducted in the form of panel discussion, during which each speaker will be given 15 minutes. If anyone is having trouble hearing or viewing the webinar or is having any form of connectivity issues, please do inform this in the chat and we shall try our best to address these issues from our end. Kindly note that by default, mics of all the attendees will be on mute and only panelists will be allowed to use mic and video. If anyone from the audience would like to ask a question, they are requested to kindly use the Q&A option and to type out their question. Please do include your name as well as your organizational affiliation along with your questions. The questions will be then presented to our panel by the moderator during the question and answer sessions accordingly. While we fully encourage you to participate, we request you to please brief in your questions. We shall try our best to ensure that all the questions get answered within our allotted time. Please further note that all the opinion voiced at the SVI platform are independent opinions of the speakers and audiences and not the official policy of the SVI. This is an open house activity which will be reported in the media. The session will be live streamed on our Facebook. The full recording of the webinar will be available on our official website and our YouTube channel of the SVI. If anyone would like to tag or post screens and grabs of this event on their personal blogs, web pages, and social media, please do not forget to mention that webinar was organized by the SVI. Thank you, and I would like to invite Dr. Zafar Iqbal Cheema to give his welcome and introductory remarks.
Thank you, Sherbano. Thank you for a very adequate and a detailed introduction to all the distinguished panelists. On behalf of the SVI, I welcome the distinguished panelists and the participants of the webinar on South Asian history. I will not take time because we have invited very highly qualified and known specialists on the subjects to speak on. I think in my view, which others may or may not kindly agree, that there are three distinct perspectives on the South Asian history. One is a Western perspective, second is an Indian perspective, and the third one is a Pakistani perspective. Pakistani perspective have not so well been written in the past, where there have been some good articles and some good books on the subject, but they are limited in volume, and therefore it need to be further. That's how we took on this task, and we have published, we are in the process of publishing a book, The Challenges of Non-Proliferation, the Pakistani Perspectives, which I hope somewhere in July we will have a book launch. So the Dr. Rabia is the one who is going to speak on the Western perspective. I think West has looked into primarily on South Asia as a proliferating case, that India was the first to proliferate and Pakistan was subsequently joined India and proliferating. So that's basically a proliferation perspective. West does not look into whether India's drive for joining nuclear weapons capability was legitimate from the point of view of security or its perspective on power politics, or whether Pakistan has been in a realist paradigm, joining after India by about 20 years or so in developing nuclear weapons capabilities. So they have lumped together as a proliferation cases. The change is only recently since India and United States of America has signed an Indo-US nuclear deal, and India and United States have become partners in a strategic partnership beginning from the 2000s to until today in various forms and formulations. Therefore, the American criticism of India is now muted, quite muted in fact, and the emphasis is now on Pakistan for different reasons. So then there is a second perspective, is the Indian perspective. The Indian perspective is basically, in my view, is a power politics perspective, that India considered itself right from the beginning, right from the time of 1947 independence, as a great power. And if you kindly go through, if you read, refresh yourself with Nehru's statement just before independence in 1946, at the time of independence and throughout the 50s and 60s when he was alive, he has highlighted that India is going to be a great power. It is, in fact, the word he used is India is destined to be a great power. And his own perspective on the India's security and foreign policy was a power politics perspective. The subsequent Indian professionals, like K. Subramaniam, who is known as the Doyen of the Indian strategists, his view was that his typical view was that nuclear weapons is a currency of international power. And in the 50s, India has been following a nuclear weapons program in which the military option was built in within the peaceful uses of India's nuclear program to develop that. And then eventually, Baba was the one who was the technological father of the Indian nuclear program. So he has devised, I have looked into the Indian development strategy. In fact, my book, the chapter 2 is on the development strategy of India's nuclear program. How has India developed? How has they, from a technological perspective, built in a nuclear weapons capability within the Indian nuclear program? And they have kept it safeguarded from the application of international safeguards by adopting a nuclear diplomacy, which is unique and which needs to be studied. I'm sure Dr. Adil Sultan is going to speak on that subject, so I will not highlight that much greater. The only point I differ with many Western analysts on the Indian perspective on nuclear weapons is many Westerns share a perspective that India developed nuclear weapons capability in reaction to China's first nuclear test at Lop Nor in October 1964. I reject that point of view. My point of view is that India's nuclear weapons program is prior to China, and it has taken shape in the 1950s and 1960s. Then, of course, is Pakistan's perspective on the nuclear weapons program. Pakistan's perspective is a realist perspective, which is motivated from a realist paradigm. Pakistan has been supporting the non-proliferation regime. Particularly, it has been supporting the conclusion of the NPT in the 18 Nation Disarmament Committee. It has been a supporter, strong supporter of that. It only did not join from a geopolitical and geostrategic perspective because India did not sign that. It has been quite straightforward on the very subject that because threat to Pakistan, and we have a conflict-ridden history because threat to Pakistan come primarily from the Indian conventional military and strategic weapons capability. So Pakistan did not sign the NPT and did not wholeheartedly support the non-proliferation because India has gone nuclear. And if India has gone nuclear, there is no defense against nuclear weapons, and Pakistan ought to go nuclear. By 1974, when India has conducted the first nuclear test, the Indian nuclear weapons policy has matured almost, although they had taken a plea hidden before a peaceful nuclear explosion. That was a cover-up story, which is now fully exposed. All Indian decision makers recognized that PNE was a cover for the weapon test which they carried out in 1974. Pakistan's program started with Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto becoming the prime minister in 1970. Or 1971, to precisely say that. A very famous Multan meeting is quoted, after which Pakistan has also gone through. But I think after 1974 Indian nuclear test, the Pakistani program is also accelerated at the same time. And Pakistan then eventually gate crashed into a nuclear weapons capability. Similarly, the 1998 nuclear tests are looked upon very, very differently. Initially, there was a combined perspective by the United States of America and the Western countries that India and Pakistan are de facto nuclear weapon states, but not de jure weapon states, because they are not covered by the NPT's clause that only those countries can be accepted as de jure nuclear weapon states, which has gone nuclear by January 1967. Well, there's a great dilemma which the NPT is suffering from. I'm sure Adil Sultan has written a book on that, and he will dwell on that very subject, that how we are going to live with this dilemma that there are nuclear weapon states, India, Pakistan, Israel, North Korea, which are not weapon state members of the NPT, and how is that crisis to be resolved, if ever that would be resolved. I don't think at the moment there are any signs that is going to be resolved at the international level. So I leave it to the three panelists to kindly share their presentations. They are all distinguished panelists. They are very professionally advanced in their careers, and I'm sure we are going to have a good webinar on the subject. I'll hand back to Sherbanu. I think you are going to request the distinguished panelists one by one to speak on the associated, the particular topic. Over to you, Sherbanu. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to invite our first guest speaker, Dr. Rabia Akhtar, to present her views on history and evolution of nuclear program and policy in South Asia, a Western perspective. The floor is yours, ma'am.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. I would like to thank Dr. Zafar Iqbal Cheema for inviting me to join this August panel on perspectives on South Asian nuclear history. I'll be speaking about the Western perspective, and as Dr. Zafar Cheema has alluded to, it is a perspective of proliferation in South Asia. So it is only pertinent that we talk about the non-proliferation policy that the US developed, because US was leading and is still leading the non-proliferation regime. I think at the outset, I'll try to be in time zone of 15 minutes, although it is really difficult to talk about history in a short time. I think at the outset, I would like to state that the US turned a blind eye to both Pakistan and Indian nuclear developments during the 70s, 80s, and 90s. But the non-proliferation policy specific to Pakistan, especially with respect to country-specific sanctions, was punitive exclusively for Pakistan. There is no shortcut to history, so I'll take you on this journey by looking at how the US non-proliferation policy took shape towards Pakistan and India differently, as briefly as I can. The prologue of Pakistan-US relations that was inherited by the Ford administration in 1974 was written in 1965, when the US placed India and Pakistan under arms embargo after both countries violated the terms of US-supplied military assistance program equipment during their war of 1965. 3 months before Ford took office, India had conducted its first nuclear explosive test on May 1874. By separating plutonium from the spent fuel from its Canadian-supplied nuclear reactor Cyrus, for which heavy water was supplied by the United States. The Indian nuclear test, which was dubbed as PNE, was criticized worldwide for violating the integrity of bilateral nuclear agreements with Canada and the US, also highlighted the dangers of nuclear proliferation in a world where many countries had signed similar multilateral agreements for their nuclear facilities to pursue peaceful nuclear energy programs. Pakistan also joined other countries in criticizing India for its decision, but India's nuclear test hardly came as a surprise for Pakistan's government or its scientific community. Even though the test was conducted during Ford's vice presidency in the Nixon administration, the Indian nuclear test single-handedly defined the contours of Ford's non-proliferation policy towards Pakistan during his presidency. And the reason I say this is because the Indian nuclear test in 1974 had a direct bearing on Pakistan's national security, given their bitter history since partition. And it became a point of reference for Pakistan to seek resumption of US military supplies by the US to counter the Indian threat. There are four things that Pakistan did in order to deal with the altered strategic dynamics in South Asia after the Indian nuclear test. Number one, Pakistan decided to maintain nuclear ambiguity while seeking conventional military arms from the US to modernize its military to counter the Indian conventional and nuclear threat. Secondly, Pakistan decided to seek nuclear guarantees from major powers. Third, Pakistan decided to stay out of the non-proliferation treaty while internationalizing the issues of both regional nuclear proliferation and disarmament by voicing against the presence of nuclear weapons in the region. And finally, Pakistan decided to acquire civilian nuclear technology from various international suppliers to firstly meet its energy requirements and secondly to develop its nuclear infrastructure. So during the early 70s, the Ford administration's non-proliferation policy towards Pakistan was taking shape, and it rested on the following three things: the resumption of military supplies to Pakistan, Secondly, the administration's attempts to persuade Pakistan to cancel the French reprocessing plant agreement. And thirdly, the origins and rationale of the Symington Amendment sanctions under which Pakistan was slapped with them in 1979. So Pakistan's narrative about the denial of access to nuclear technology to meet its genuine energy needs, it finds its genesis in the 1970s. It was marked by the US tolerance for India's proliferation behavior post-74, India's breach of international nuclear agreements after its nuclear testing in 74, and the discriminate nature of US non-proliferation legislation towards Pakistan, such as the Symington Amendment. So with respect to the US, there was enough suspicion about Pakistan and its motivations to expand its nuclear program, civilian part of it at that time. The US administration was skeptical of Pakistan's intentions to acquire fuel cycle capabilities even after Bhutto's public assurances and his willingness to place all current and future facilities under the IAEA safeguards. The reasons for US skepticism were multiple. Firstly, Pakistan's nuclear energy program during the mid-70s did not justify the high cost of $1 billion of the reprocessing plant that the GOP wanted to construct and operate indigenously. Secondly, Pakistan's consistent opposition to the NPT was suspicious, since if it was genuinely interested in the expansion of a civilian nuclear energy program, it had much to gain from the international nuclear suppliers countries as NPT state party rather than as non-NPT state. Thirdly, a plutonium reprocessing plant would have given Pakistan not only expertise in the back end of the fuel cycle, but also the incentives to reprocess spent fuel from its only operational reactor at that time, the Kanup reactor in Karachi, which utilized natural uranium fuel. So based on these apprehensions and sensing latent proliferation potential in the prospective Franco-Pak plutonium reprocessing plant deal, the Ford administration established a quid pro quo with Pakistan. And this was the first ever time that the US established a quid pro quo. USG wanted sanction the sale of advanced A-7 attack aircraft, 110 of which Pakistan was interested in buying from the US, if Pakistan gave up the option of acquiring French nuclear reprocessing plant. On the US objection to Pakistan's lack of economic justification to pursue acquisition of nuclear fuel and heavy water facilities, Sahabzada Yaqub Khan, who was Pakistan's ambassador to the US at the time, argued that since Pakistan lacked fossil fuels, it had to depend on nuclear energy to meet its future power needs. Given that it would have taken Pakistan 4 years to complete a reprocessing plant, Sahabzada Yaqub Khan maintained that delay in approval of IAEA safeguards agreement would delay the completion of plant, eventually delaying Pakistan's ability to become self-sufficient in meeting its energy needs. The trilateral safeguards agreement between Pakistan, France, and the IAEA was signed on 18th of March, 76, with the vote of the US delegate on board. Kissinger advised Ford at that time on direct intervention to stop Bhutto from progressing with the reprocessing project. In 1976, Bhutto wrote a letter to Ford, and he expressed his regret that the administration was pursuing double non-proliferation standards, where it admonished Pakistan for its genuine peaceful nuclear intentions, and it rewarded India with uninterrupted nuclear fuel supply even after its nuclear testing. The US did not selectively pressure Pakistan into canceling the French deal. It also approached France for the same. And as a nuclear weapon state, France proved to be a more challenging case for US nuclear diplomacy in the mid-70s than Germany with respect to its nuclear export policies. Gaullist conceptions in the 1960s, they fashioned the policies of an independent and self-reliant France, which gate-crashed the nuclear club with its first nuclear weapons test in 60. The United States was finding it increasingly difficult to engage France in a nuclear suppliers agreement after the Indian test of 74, which would have triggered nuclear technology exports on countries that were not part of the NPT. So while the US was pressurizing the French to cancel their agreement with Pakistan, it had processed a shipment of 20,000 pounds of enriched uranium to India for use in the American-built Tarapur nuclear plant. And the US administration at that time took shelter behind the contract signed in the past between India and the US, even after India's breach of trust. The French decision finally to cancel the reprocessing agreement came in 1978. Pakistan was under the Symington sanctions when the Soviet Union entered Afghanistan in December of 1979. The US obviously turned to Pakistan to deal with this Soviet problem. There was a deadlock on the nature of US security and economic assistance to Pakistan, which continued throughout the year till the time the two leaders met in person for the first time. The session between Carter and Zia was recorded as warm and friendly. And during that meeting, Zia did not raise the subject of a security treaty, which Pakistan had been wanting from the US to secure itself from the dual Indo-Soviet threat that it faced at that time. And the two leaders also did not discuss Pakistan's nuclear issue. 1980 was also the year which tested Carter's non-proliferation credentials with respect to supply of uranium fuel for the Indian nuclear reactors at Tarapur, and it generated quite a lot of controversy. So despite significant domestic support for withholding the fuel shipments to India, Carter administration announced its decision to send shipment of enriched uranium to India on May 8, 1980. This US decision was disturbing for domestic and international audience, especially since it came after Indian Prime Minister Indira Gandhi's announcement on March 14, 1980 of conducting more nuclear tests in future if it served Indian national interest. Carter signed the executive order in 1980 to authorize Tarapur exports, stating the need for bolstering ties with South Asian nations that can play a role in checking Soviet expansionism, ignoring the fact that India was actively pursuing defense and security cooperation with the Soviet Union even after it had invaded Afghanistan in 79. And this was a fact that disturbed Pakistan to no end. Pakistan at that time maintained that India violated the terms of the 1963 Indo-US nuclear cooperation and used US-supplied heavy water in its 1974 test. And secondly, its refusal to place all its nuclear facilities under full-scope safeguards would allow India to produce nuclear weapons in future, which was a grave security concern for Pakistan, especially when the resolve to conduct further tests was publicly announced. US turned a blind eye to that as well. The take-home message for Pakistan was that nuclear non-proliferation was a flexible item on Carter's foreign policy, notwithstanding rhetoric. So Pakistan benefited the most from blind eye during a strategic engagement with the US under the two Reagan administration. With its 8-year-long engagement resulted in Soviet withdrawal from Afghanistan and the subsequent breakup of the Soviet Union, bringing an end, Pakistan as a threshold nuclear state emerged as the clear winner. Reagan certified thrice based on GOP's assurances that Pakistan was pursuing a peaceful nuclear program, even when there was overwhelming evidence that Pakistan was pursuing nuclear weapons development. The Pressler Amendment, the famous Pressler Amendment, was passed by US Congress in 85, and it became the first ever country-specific non-proliferation sanction against any country, and that country was Pakistan. However, the government of Pakistan was cool about it when it was passed. I have assessed that there could be two reasons for GOP's calmness at that time. Number one, Pakistan's overconfidence that US needed Pakistan more than Pakistan needed the US. At that time, the amendment was passed. And secondly, Pakistan's successful coal tests in 83 and 84, which provided Pakistan with the confidence that it had already achieved the capability and sanctions would not be too damaging if they did come. October 1st, 1990, it is etched in the memory of many Pakistanis as the date on which the US showed its true colors and parted ways with its one-time ally, Pakistan. But more than that, what Pakistanis remember of October 1990 is that it was when US slammed Pakistan with Pressler sanctions. In the absence of President Bush making a certification and determination on Pakistan's lack of possession of nuclear weapons, the amendment automatically went into effect on October 1st, 1990. But again, it was not a surprise for Pakistan, at least not for the GOP, because it had been forewarned. For the Pressler law to take effect, final assembly of a nuclear explosive device was not a requirement to meet the Pressler Amendment definition of possession of a nuclear device. So further, in order for Pakistan to escape the Pressler sanctions, it was essential that Pakistan not possess even one highly enriched uranium core. The Sharif government at that time had inherited the Presley sanctions and their consequences, the biggest of being the issue of continued payments and subsequent release of the F-16s that were held. The Bush administration attempted to find a way to get those to Pakistan, but the congressional odds at that time were against them. So among the foreign policy challenges that Clinton inherited from Bush administration, Pakistan's continuing advances in nuclear weapons development, Pak-China Nuclear Technology Cooperation, Indo-Pak tensions over Kashmir, they dictated his South Asia foreign policy and non-proliferation agenda. At the beginning of his term, Clinton set out his non-proliferation agenda to achieve the CTBT by 1996, and also to achieve a global consensus on FMCT. Though the international community welcomed his initiatives, South Asia, with India and Pakistan as two nuclear threshold states, they posed challenges for the administration. Clinton's eight years in office corresponded with Pakistan's final march towards overt nuclear capability. India and in response to Pakistan, they tested their nuclear weapons in May 1998, triggering the Glenn-Symington sanctions against both countries, perhaps the only time Pakistan was satisfied about equitable non-proliferation justice meted out by any US administration. The Clinton administration's non-proliferation policy has been heavily criticized over the period of years for Pakistan. Sorry, that's my timer that has gone on. The Clinton administration policy has been heavily criticized over a period of years, but for Pakistan, these final 8 years were critical in perfecting and testing its nuclear weapons capability. Both Benazir Bhutto and Nawaz Sharif, they refused to give in to any pressure, negligible as it was, on Pakistan's nuclear weapons program. Lastly, it appears that although non-proliferation policy by each administration, Ford, Carter, Reagan, Bush, Clinton, was designed to create an imbalance in favor of Pakistan not going nuclear, yet it ended up with achieving just the opposite. I would end here and I look forward to the Q&A. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Abia.
Thank you so much, ma'am, Dr. Abia, for such a comprehensive presentation. Now I would like to invite Dr. Adil Sultan to present his views on evolution of Indian nuclear program and its nuclear diplomacy historiographic perspective. Floor is yours, sir.
Thank you, Sherbano. Thank you, SVI and Dr. Zafar Chima for organizing this event. What Dr. Chima at the beginning stated, and he gave a very elaborated India's nuclear program. I think the book that he has written and the views that he shares often with us as being student of Dr. Chima, I think there's not much else to say, because whatever he has written in his book, India's nuclear history, I think that's very comprehensive work from a Pakistani perspective. The one thing that Dr. Chima said, that probably I'll be giving Indian perspective. I don't think so. I'll be giving Indian perspective. So what I'm trying to do is giving a Pakistani perspective, how India's nuclear program evolved over the last many decades, and how Indians, they tried to explain to the international community what Dr. Chima also said about this, that they continue to tell the international community that the nuclear program is because of the Chinese threat perception, but in fact, it is not. And I'll during my remarks, I'll explain that also. So I'll be very brief in my remarks, because Dr. Rabe has very elaborately explained about the history of South Asia nuclear program, in which India's nuclear program was also briefly touched, and the Pakistani also program. So two main conclusions. India's nuclear program was driven by a prestige factor. It was a primary consideration. Many Indian scholars, they do not agree to that. They continue to state that security was the major consideration for them, but I'll explain why it is not. And I'll also adopt an academic approach to explain why these models are important to understand the real proliferation drivers of many nuclear weapon states. Second, on to the nuclear diplomacy. India's nuclear diplomacy has always been to project itself as a responsible country while creating an option to develop nuclear weapons programs. So I'll cover these two aspects in my brief remarks. So before that, for some of you who are not very well conversant about the proliferation drivers, I would suggest that several scholars have discussed nuclear proliferation of all the nuclear weapon states, and they have taken different models, but I prefer to take Scott Sagan's model, which has also been taken by other scholars also. According to these models, states proliferate because of the three primary considerations. Number one, security. Number two, domestic politics. And number three, because of the prestige factor or the norms model. So these are the three essential models, but not necessarily there is only one model which would drive nuclear proliferation of a particular state. There could be a combination of one or two models, which Scott Sagan tells us multi-causality. So keeping in view in these models, the norms model, first, let me first briefly elaborate also. Norms model state that states acquire nuclear weapons because they want to be equated with other major powers and they want to be seen as great powers. So they acquire nuclear weapons. Security, as this name suggests, states feel insecure from the existential threats or the external threats, and they build the capability to ward off those threats. So that's security. Third is the domestic politics model. Domestic politics states that the stakeholders or strategic enclave, which also talks about the military and the civilian bureaucracy and the scientific establishment and the political leadership, all those actors, they play their role in countries' nuclear development program. So that is domestic politics model. So after giving you this, these three brief explanation of these models, let's now analyze India's nuclear program. As Dr. Chima said, India started its nuclear program in early 50s. In fact, just after 1947, India started to pursue its dual track nuclear program. And why it is important to understand, because after Hiroshima and Nagasaki, Nehru had that vision that if India has to emerge as a great power in the future, so nuclear capability is one which can give this advantage to India, and India has to pursue this nuclear weapons option at that time. So this nuclear program was started soon after independence in 1950s, and the program was under Prime Minister Nehru directly. In 1959, see the statement by Homi Bhabha. He gave the statement that India has the potential to build a bomb if the political leadership, within a few months, if the political leadership gives a go ahead. Whether India had the potential or not at that time in 1959, but the statement indicates that there was a serious intent amongst India's strategic enclave to pursue nuclear weapons program. And for the reasons I'll elaborate subsequently. So if we see the genesis of India's nuclear program, China did not figure at all in India's nuclear evolution process. It was not seen as a major threat. In fact, China-India relations were very cordial during that period. And as in our local language, they say, Hindi-Chini Bhaiwei, there were slogans of that kind. So that kind of relationship was there between China and India. So China was never an existential threat which could have triggered this new thinking amongst India's leadership to pursue nuclear weapons program. And as Dr. Chima also said, 1962, India and China both went to border conflict. I don't call it as a war, but that was one of the military crises. So if India was already on track to producing nuclear weapons program, the 1962 crisis with China did not create any urgency amongst India's decision makers. And this we see from Nehru's, from the statements by the political leadership in the parliaments. A.T. Abraham has written a book, but Dr. Chima has also quoted in his work. So there were several statements. There was some debate after 1962 that India should build a capability, but there was no serious focus on building a nuclear weapon program. The point that I want to bring in, if China was a major consideration, this crisis should have expedited India's nuclear program. And again, in 1964, once China conducted a nuclear test, there was debate amongst India's parliament, but there was no sense of urgency to quickly build a nuclear weapons program. Now, refer back to Baba's statement of 1959 also. So having that intent, but there was no urgency amongst the political leadership to build that program. Then India continued to build its nuclear program. And in 1974, it tested the first device, which it termed as a peaceful nuclear explosion. Why it was termed as peaceful nuclear explosion? Again, India could not justify that there is an existential threat or alleged threat from China that could have otherwise given a reason for the Indian leadership to project it as against China specific. Peaceful nuclear explosion, this term, some writings also suggest this idea came from the United States, that United States in fact wanted India to have that potential, but to avoid those sanctions, because the United States had to apply a sanction if it was declared a nuclear weapon test. So this term was also probably coined by United States or suggested by the US policymakers to India, how to escape those sanctions and declare it as a peaceful nuclear explosion. But subsequently, the Indian scientists who were involved in that 1974 test, they have also written that there was nothing peaceful about 1974. It was, in fact, a weapons test. So this was the first weapon test that India carried out in 1974. There was also an element of domestic politics in this test, because Indira Gandhi was under crisis. She was there was unrest in India, and Indira Gandhi wanted to establish her credentials as a nationalist leader, and probably she used that 1974 test to build that nuclear nationalism in India, which we continue to see as of now also. About this aspect of 1974, how it was, how peaceful nuclear technology was misused to develop nuclear weapon tests, Dr. Rabe has very elaborately explained how the fuel was provided with by the United States, the reactor, the Cyrus reactor used by Canada, and India used it for military purposes. I'll skip that part, but that also shows how India was trying to project to the rest of the international community that it is not building weapons, but it was using that technology and was using international existing regimes at that time to build its nuclear capability. Now if we move in the 1990s, because generally it is believed that India's nuclear program, probably the nuclear test, 1998 test, the credit is given to the BJP government because of their nationalist agenda. But if you see in 1996, Narasimha Rao, who was not from the BJP, he also attempted to test for different reasons, and that I'll briefly explain. But he did try to test and declare India as a nuclear weapon state, but United States, they got that information. They picked up from satellite imageries, and they prevented India from testing a nuclear device in 1996. So the intent was always there to declare India as a nuclear weapon state, but there was no significant or credible justification for India to give it to the rest of the international community. 1996 test was also because of the ongoing debate on CTBT. President Clinton, as Dr. Rabia mentioned, wanted to finalize this treaty. And India was looking at this window of opportunity that before CTBT gets into force, India should become a nuclear weapon state, because afterwards their options would be closed. So that was also triggered by it. In 1996, I.K. Gujral, India's former minister, also gave that famous statement that Indians have a third eye. There are two ways to get into the United Nations Security Council. One is the economic development, and the other is nuclear weapons path. So economic development is a longer process, and nuclear weapons are a shortcut. So that also reflects Indian thinking. They wanted to build the nuclear capability and demonstrate the nuclear capability and get a seat at the United Nations Security Council. 1998 test, We all know, I'll not go into detail, but the statement that came out, what, it is the right of 1/6 of humanity. And there were also some talked about the Hindu bombs or the right of the Hindu civilization. So that kind of sentiments were ingrained amongst BJP's election manifesto also, and they wanted to tell or give that message to their own public and to the rest of the international community. The Hindu bomb has come, and India should be recognized as a nuclear weapon state. It is our right, the right of Hindu civilization. That's very important. Post 1998, there was some sanctions, but interestingly, during the same period, India and United States were having this bilateral dialogue, how to mainstream India or bring India into mainstream non-proliferation regime. And that culminated into 2004 Next Steps in Strategic Partnership, which had several elements that included cooperation in nuclear and space and other strategic and dual use technology, and which also resulted into India-US nuclear strategic partnership, or the July 18, 2005 statement that we talked as India-US strategic partnership. So one of the important component of that India-US strategic partnership was India-US nuclear deal. And we can discuss this during question answer session. I'm sure many of the participants, they are well conversant with this. So to conclude about the India's nuclear major drivers, prestige was the major factor in India's nuclear weapons development over a period of time. Yes, domestic politics also started to play important role in vertical proliferation, and the security, more specifically projecting that China is a major threat. It's a more recent phenomena, but I do not deny, because as India grows in its size, definitely its interest would also change, and it might see China as a principal adversary, or China might become a principal adversary in the future. So as India evolves, its secured power potential evolves, its security interests would also change. So we can say in future, but the major drivers were prestige. Now, briefly talking about diplomacy, because that was second part, and I'll just briefly cover. India was one of those countries which led that NPT negotiations, and it was part of 18 Nation Disarmament Committee. It forced United States, along with other NAM countries also, to agree to this quid pro quo grand bargain that we talked, that in if non-nuclear weapon states, they agree to not pursue nuclear weapons, the nuclear weapon states should also give a commitment that they will disarm. So India was spearheading that campaign, and this was agreed. But once NPT was open for signature, India refused, calling it as a nuclear apartheid. Likewise, on the CTBT, India spearheaded, it joined the discussions and negotiations, but CTBT, once it was open for signatures, India refused. Similarly, on the FMCT, it was the co-sponsor of the resolution on the Fissile Material Treaty earlier, once this resolution came, but it advocated that existing stock should not be included. And we have seen FMCT politics, and I'll leave it again to the question answer session. Finally, on the export control regime, the whole debate on India's membership of the NSG is also driven by its consideration to be equated with other major powers, to be recognized as a nuclear weapon state outside the NPT norms. Because as Dr. Chima said, under Article 9 of the NPT, India, Pakistan, Israel cannot be seen as considered as nuclear weapon states. But one point that I would like to mention over here, this term of de facto, de jure, this is only for the interpretation of the NPT only. Otherwise, legally, India, Pakistan, Israel are nuclear weapon states, because we never violated any international treaty that we had signed. So in that context, but we'll debate on that also. Coming to this NSC debate, this whole issue, because India got the exemption in 2008, so India is technically qualified to receive nuclear-related dual-use technology from the NSC member states. But India wants to become a member of the NSC, just because it can give India that prestige that it is being equated with other nuclear weapon states. In fact, if India becomes the NSG member, India would have more privileges as compared to the nuclear weapon states who have signed the NPT, because the NPT nuclear weapon states, they have an obligation under Article 6 to work in good faith towards nuclear disarmament. But if India is incorporated or brought into mainstream non-proliferation regime without signing the NPT, so India will have all the privileges of the nuclear weapon states and without any quid pro quo, any reciprocal obligations or a commitment to work in good faith towards nuclear disarmament. So in fact, India has more privileges, would have more privileges than other nuclear weapon states. So this whole debate on the NSG is also driven by its consideration for prestige. It wants to be equated with other nuclear weapon states. So that is it. So finally, if you see the genesis or the proliferation driver or the motivations, they were primarily prestige. And if you see nuclear diplomacy, that is also guided by the prestige factor or the norms consideration that India wants to be seen at par with other nuclear weapon states. I'll stop here because I've overshot by 3 minutes, and I'll be happy to answer any question due to question answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Zafar Khan to present his views on Pakistan's perspective on the South Asian nuclear history.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yes, sir, we can hear
That's
you.
That's right. Okay, so thank you so much for the invitation. Thank you, Zafar Iqbal Chima. Thank you, Sir Bano, for the introduction. Hello to everyone. While being part of this webinar, I wish we could do such an important issue physically as we have done in the past prior to outbreak of the COVID pandemic. Unfortunately, the ongoing pandemic has sickened and taken many lives and indeed has disrupted many things around the globe, including Pakistan. With all the best care we can follow hope, we hope to get out of this complex time very soon. I'm given my part entitled Pakistan Perspective on the South Asian Nuclear History. In the next 10 to 15 minutes, I'll try to speak on it more broadly rather than more specifically, because then otherwise I would be repeating what has already been said or done in the existing literature when it comes to the specifics of South Asian nuclear history. I'll try to cover up a few overarching questions. Why does history in general and nuclear history in particular matter? What can be the key implication of nuclear history for South Asian nuclear arrivals? How might we learn from such a robust nuclear history comprising many nuclear weapon states? What lessons we might learn from nuclear history amidst evolving nuclear posture, forced modernization and emerging technologies and their implication on nuclear policies? It's important to note that things change over a certain span of time, and such changes would then become the essential part of history. That is, what happens today will become part of history, depending much on how we treat such changes for our conceptual understanding on the given issue. Many IR theories, more importantly, realism, the leading and the predominant theory, largely depends on credible and rich historical and empirical evidence. Therefore, history remains an important part of a stronger theoretical explanation for understanding better what is going on in the present, and obviously conceptualizing more accurately what may or may not happen in the future. South Asian nuclear history has always been significantly reactive to the evolving environment. That is how one state's strategic posturing affects the strategic posturing of potential adversary. In other words, it can be observed how the South Asian policy posturing are affected by the major nuclear powers. For example, as the cycle goes on, the US was the first country to develop and use nuclear weapons. This was out of the fear that its potential adversary, Germany, during the Second World War would develop and use these deadly weapons against the US and its allies. Then the Soviet Union were under the tremendous fear and pressure and developed its own nuclear weapons rather quite quickly. The UK, France, China followed suit by developing nuclear weapons. Since India and China have been strategic rivals for many decades, and we know that they had a short war in 1962, India started to build its nuclear weapons in reaction to China becoming an established nuclear weapon state in 1964. Of course, Pakistan followed suit, India's nuclear weapon test, purely for security reason. North Korea, because of its security threat perception, developed and tested its nuclear weapons, and Israel has already developed but never tested its nuclear capability to potentially prevent yet another Holocaust. The point is that South Asian nuclear history teaches us that in addition to many other factors, security remains the predominant factor for a state acquiring nuclear weapons. One of the major implications we may learn from broader nuclear history is that nuclear weapons speak volume for deterring potential adversaries. This entails that nuclear weapons remain the ultimate guarantor for peace and stability. If these weapons are credible, reliable, and secured enough for many nuclear weapon states, including that of South Asian nuclear rivals. Just imagine if there were no nuclear weapons between the potential nuclear adversaries, how would the world look like with the so-called conventional deterrence? One of John Mersheimer's key books on conventional deterrence reminds us how badly conventional deterrence absent from nuclear deterrence failed in recent history. The South Asian nuclear history is predominantly affected and influenced by the Cold War nuclear history. Therefore, as part of the implication, the South Asian nuclear history and its analysis contain many essential concepts originating in the Cold War nuclear history, when both the Soviet Union and the US developed various combination of strategic posturing on why and how and when to use these nuclear weapons. The effects of development of these weapons for security and deterrence purposes have also been remarkably interesting. Despite several serious military and nuclear crises, both the Soviet Union and the US did not wage a war, a major direct military war, because of the fear of the escalation to a nuclear level. South Asian nuclear rivals also have not fought direct major war since the arrival of nuclear weapons, although both India and Pakistan confronted a number of serious crises. South Asian nuclear history learns from the Cold War nuclear history that nuclear weapons are not the panacea to all the solutions. By the way, this was thinking in the 1950s and 60s in the US nuclear posturing as well, when they thought that the nuclear weapons is the panacea to all or solution to all the problem. But later on, they realized that nuclear weapons are not the panacea, not the solution to all these issues. But these weapons have deterring volume which ultimately matters for state security. When it comes to learning points from nuclear history, one of the key learning caveats can be the South Asian nuclear weapons have revolutionized the relationship between South Asian nuclear rivals. That said, even though South Asian nuclear rivals have confronted several serious crises and they do not talk formally and directly to each other, but nuclear weapons have prevented both sides to wage bigger wars any longer because of the fear of the escalation to an unthinkable that neither sides would want this to happen in the first place. The recent South Asian nuclear history teaches South Asian nuclear rivals that there might be a nuclear victory, particularly when both sides possess credible, there might not be nuclear victory, particularly when both sides possess credible nuclear weapons. Even though nuclear weapons bolstered with modernized conventional forces might provide incentive for preemptive strikes, escalation dominance, and nuclear saber rattling, South Asian nuclear rivals may not even afford to wage a limited war because such could also spiral out of control, perhaps letting the South Asian rational leadership say what once the European leader stated after the First World War, alas, if we only knew it. Yet there still can be other important lessons we learn from South Asian nuclear history. A, nuclear weapons would stay as long as nuclear weapon exists in the world. B, nuclear weapons are and should always be used for deterrent purposes, for preventing major wars. C, credible nuclear deterrence diminishes the concept of smaller and bigger states. For example, a smaller state while possessing credible weapons and their delivery system can potentially deter the much larger nuclear adversary. And D, although nuclear disarmament may not simply be possible for a variety of reasons, nuclear arms control can be and to produce a period of relaxation, encourage deterrent stability, and prevent the risk of military escalation between nuclear rivals. In addition to key implication and learning caveats out of South Asian nuclear history, it is also imperative to note a few possible thoughts on how nuclear history teaches us the arrival of emerging technologies and the implication of such technologies on nuclear force posturing. Emerging technologies matter. Many scholars in existing literature reflect that those who lag behind in terms of acquiring nuclear or new technologies or emerging technologies could suffer much both in the shorter and the longer terms. Many nuclear weapon states may soon be able to achieve capacity for acquiring and developing emerging technologies, potentially undermining the broader strategic stability in terms of potential risk of dangerous escalation, crises, new pattern of arms race in the new era of evolving technology. To this end, the inclusion of Cold War technologies such as the canopy wing, espionage, and single intelligence signal intelligence, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, and more recently focusing much more on the new technologies such as the speed, potentially bolstered by hypersonic glide vehicles, hyperspectral imaging, artificial intelligence for identifying fixed facility, probably nuclear missile sites if the two are combined and used together. Sensors such as the unattended ground sensors, tagging, tracking, locating, signal intelligence, automated targeting recognition, and ground moving target indicator, particularly for locating and targeting the mobile missiles. The unmanned aerial vehicles, that is drones, cyber electronic warfare capabilities, et cetera. All these emerging and disruptive technologies reflect that nothing can substantially be hidden in the new era of technology. Therefore, everything for everyone while possessing sophisticated technology may become vulnerable to preemptive strikes. Arguably, students of nuclear history may not miss how these emerging technologies in the changing realm of nuclear strategy may have the benefits and risks for nuclear weapon states much more in the 21st century of nuclear politics. I think the South Asian nuclear historians will be much more interested to observe the arrival and effects of emerging technologies on South Asian deterrence stability. To sum up, I would argue the South Asian nuclear history can teach us lots of things with regard to deterrence capability, capacity, better communication, force posturing, and indeed the new era of emerging technologies that every nuclear weapon state, for that matter, would desire to do so for multiple key objectives. One, power projection; two, escalation dominance; three, an edge against the potential adversary; four, confidence and incentives for preemptive strike whenever and however these countries would like; and five, rebel settling, saber rattling for containment and deterrent purposes; and six, making a new history from the existing history. Also, while learning from the Cold War nuclear history, perhaps South Asian nuclear history could probably provide a learning statement. That is, the production of strategic restraint regime for initiating some type of arms control mechanism applicable to the South Asian strategic environment, managing serious conflicts, potentially preventing accidental nuclear war, stopping bigger arms race, and more importantly, promoting strategic stability in South Asia. So I stop here and leave the rest for Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Zafar Khan. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Toghrul Yameen to present his views on current trends in global politics of non-proliferation, a South Asian perspective.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Shukriya bahut bahut Dr. Zafar Iqbal Cheema. Shukriya bahut bahut Sher Bano mujhe is program pe madhu karne ka. Main Urdu mein bolunga. Main dekh raha hu ki aapke paas 49 se 50 participants hain aur 7 panelists hain, tamam Pakistani hain. To meri baat log samajh jayenge. Main koshish karunga ki is mauzu jo mujhe diya gaya usko aasan, dilchasp, aam fehm banaun taaki aap logon ko mushkilat na pesh aaye isko samajhne mein. देखें, सबसे पहली बात तो ये कि जहाँ तक हमारे इसका न्यूक्लियर नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन का ताल्लुक है साउथ एशिया में, ये तो एक जगह पहुँच गया, रुक गया है. देखें, कोई इस पर मज़ीद बहस नहीं हो रही. आपके पास न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं, दुश्मन के पास भी न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं. जो आपके दुश्मन अल-एलान नहीं हैं, वो उनको भी पता है आपके पास क्या है. वो आपसे ना आपके हथियार छीन सकते हैं अगर आप खुद अपने हथियार ना देना चाहें. और सबसे बड़ी बात आजकल के ज़माने में वो ये है कि अगर किसी अदम फैलाव की बात होनी है तो वो आप जनाब कोरोना के अदम फैलाव की बात करें. इसमें तो मुझे ऐसा लग रहा है कि पाकिस्तान हिंदुस्तान कोलैबोरेट भी करना चाह रहे हैं. मुझे तो लग रहा है और जगह पे भी कोलैबोरेट करना चाह रहे हैं. हमने बड़ी लंबी चौड़ी तारीफ अभी मेरे बड़े बेटर मुझसे बेहतर मुकाला निगार थे जिन्होंने बहुत अच्छी तारीख के बारे में बातचीत की. मगर इस वक्त तो ऐसा लग रहा है कि हम लोग तावन की रास्ते पे चल रहे हैं. तो मैं और देखें, जो जब आप न्यूक्लियर नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन या आदम फैलाव की बात करते हैं तो उसको आप साउथ एशिया तक महदूद नहीं कर सकते. ये एक बहुत वसी कैनवस है, इस पर बहुत से मुख्तलिफ ममालिक भी आते हैं. और मैं जो आज बातचीत करूँगा वो साउथ एशिया तक महदूद नहीं होगी. ठीक है, तो ये मैं आपके साथ अपना स्क्रीन शेयर करता हूँ. अगर किसी को मेरी उर्दू में बात नहीं समझ आ रही तो ये अंग्रेज़ी में है स्क्रीन जो है, और आप लोगों को इंशाल्लाह समझ आ जाएगी जो मैं कहने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ. दो सेकंड मेरे साथ वो कीजिएगा, बेयर विद मी फॉर अ फ्यू सेकंड्स. मैं आई जस्ट ट्राई एंड ब्रिंग माय जनाब, नज़र आ रही है शेरवानो आपको मेरी प्रेजेंटेशन? नज़र आ रही है?
यस सर, यस सर, वी कैन सी द प्रेजेंटेशन.
शुक्रिया बहुत। अच्छा देखिए ये जो मैं आपसे बातचीत करना चाह रहा हूँ, मैं बहुत ज़्यादा बात नहीं करूँगा, लोगों ने बहुत सेर हासिल बहस हो चुकी है, सब लोगों ने बड़े तफसील से बातें की हैं, और मेरा ख्याल में अगर मैं वही बात करूँगा तो मैं दोहरा ज़्यादा रहूँगा। तो देखिए ये मैं आपको चंद बेसिक बातें बताना चाहता हूँ नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन स्ट्रेटजीज में। वो सबसे पहले तो सिफारती अमल होते हैं जो बायलैटरल भी हो सकते हैं, जैसे हमने देखा सॉल्ट स्टार्ट, इस किस्म की ट्रीटीज थी। पाकिस्तान इंडिया के दरमियान कोई ट्रीटी नहीं है, ये जो लोग भी एग्डा वगैरह में काम करते रहे हैं, डॉक्टर आदिल सुल्तान वगैरह आपको बताएंगे कि पाकिस्तान और इंडिया के दरमियान कोई ट्रीटी नहीं है बायलैटरल। मल्टीलैटरल ट्रीटीज जो हैं उसमें हमने कहते हैं हम जब तक इंडिया नहीं साइन करेगा एनपीटी हम नहीं करेंगे, सीटीबीटी पे भी हमारा यही है, एफएमसीटी या जो भी हम उसका नाम देते हैं उस पे भी हमारा यही वो है नुकता नज़र। उसके अलावा जो नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन स्ट्रेटजीज होती हैं उसमें पॉलिटिकल और इकोनॉमिक सेंक्शंस लगाई जाती हैं, सिफारती और इकोनॉमिक आप पे रिस्ट्रिक्शंस लगा दी जाती हैं। पाकिस्तान में इस पे डॉक्टर राबिया ने बहुत लंबी बातचीत की प्रेसलर अमेंडमेंट के, सेमिंगटन अमेंडमेंट के, और तमाम इस किस्म की जो टैक्टिस हैं वो इस्तेमाल किए जाते हैं। और सिफारती तौर पे भी आपको आइसोलेट किया जाता है, आपको कोल्ड वॉर के बाद हम ऐसा किया गया, पाकिस्तान को तकरीबन एक कॉर्नर में पुश कर दिया गया, और बड़ी मुश्किल हुई पाकिस्तान को दोबारा री इंटीग्रेट करने के लिए आर्मी बरदरी के साथ। फिर आपके खिलाफ थ्रेट्स भी इस्तेमाल होती हैं, कोशंस भी इस्तेमाल होती हैं, हमें पता है वो बहुत मशहूर जो किसिंजर साहब ने भुट्टो साहब से कहा था, आई मेक अ हॉरिबल एग्जांपल आउट ऑफ यू, शायद राबिया साहिबा ने अपनी किसी किताब में या किसी जगह उसका तस्करा भी किया है। तो डायरेक्ट आपको आके धमकियाँ भी दी जाती हैं, कुछ थर्ड पार्टी के थ्रू भी धमकियाँ दी जाती हैं, बहुत से मुख्तलिफ तरीक़ों से आपको धमकाया जाता है कि भाई बाज रहो, मगर ये तमाम चीज़ें उस वक्त तक होती हैं जब तक आपने अपना न्यूक्लियर वेपन नहीं बना लिया होता। और एक हमने देखा है काइनेटिक मींस होते हैं, यानी आप बज़ोर शमशीर यानी ताकत के ज़रिए आप हमला करते हैं और दूसरे मुल्क की जो भी कैपेबिलिटी है उसको तबाह बर्बाद कर देते हैं। और हमने देखा कि ये इराक के सिलसिले में भी हुआ और किसी हद तक सीरिया में भी हुआ, मगर सीरिया में धमकियों से उन्होंने सीरिया को इतना दबा दिया कि सीरिया ने फौरन साइन कर दिया CWC केमिकल वेपन। तो और एक और चीज़ है टेक्नोलॉजी के बारे में, डॉक्टर जफर साहब ने बड़ी लंबी चौड़ी बात की, टेक्नोलॉजी जो है ना आगे जो होगा वो टेक्नोलॉजी के जरिए होगा, साइबर थ्रेट्स होंगी और चीज़ें होंगी, ये मेरे ख्याल में बाकी तमाम चीज़ें जो हैं ये नापैद हो जाएंगी, ये तमाम तारीख के कूड़ेदान में चली जाएंगी, ये मेरा मानना है। अच्छा देखिए ये करंट ट्रेंड्स के बारे में थोड़ी सी तारीख मैं भी दोहरा दूँ, इसमें तीन स्टेजेस आई थी मेरे मानने के मुताबिक नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन की। पहली जो थी स्टेज जो नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन की थी वो कोल्ड वॉर के दौरान थी, सर्द जंग के दौरान थी, और इसमें बेसिक बात वो ये हुई कि मुख्तलिफ उन्होंने एक ट्रीटीज़ का एक जाल बुन दिया, पहले वो बायलैटरल ट्रीटीज थी वो फिर मल्टीलैटरल ट्रीटीज़ हो गई, और उसमें होते होते उन्हें तमाम मुल्कों को जकड़ लिया, और उसमें बेसिक बात यही थी कि पांच बड़े हैं जिनको न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स ऑथराइज हैं, बाकी कोई नहीं ले सकता, सिंपल एज दैट, ठीक है। और दूसरी स्टेज जो थी वो नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन की जो थी वो ये कि USA ने सोवियत रिपब्लिक, सोवियत यूनियन, फॉर्मर सोवियत यूनियन की मदद की कि ये अपने न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स को तबाह कर सकें, बाकायदा इनको नून लोगर स्कीम के तहत इनको बहुत पैसा दिया गया और इन्होंने इसका फ़ायदा भी उठाया, ठीक है। और इसके अलावा ग्रुप्स बना लिए NSG, वो कोल्ड वॉर में बन गए थे एक्चुअली, मगर चले इनकी ज़्यादा अहमियत ज़्यादा कोल्ड वॉर के पीरियड में हो गई। और थर्ड एज ऑफ न्यूक्लियर नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन जो है वो एग्रेसिव है, ताकत के ज़ोर से है, धमकियों के ज़ोर से है, लड़ाका फौज के ज़रिए है, और टेक्नोलॉजी के ज़रिए, ठीक है। तो ये तीन अद्वार रहे हैं नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन के, उसमें उसकी लपेट में साउथ एशिया भी आया है, पूरी दुनिया आई है। अच्छा इसमें काइनेटिक और कोअर्सिव नॉन प्रोलिफरेशन में तीन केस स्टडीज़ हैं हमारे पास बड़ी वाजे, और मैं अपने स्टूडेंट्स को ये देता रहता हूँ उस पर तहकीक करने के लिए, और चूंकि इसमें ज़्यादा लिटरेचर अवेलेबल नहीं, इनको अक्सर प्रॉब्लम होती है, ज़्यादातर ये लोग वेस्टर्न उसको कोट कर रहे होते हैं। देखें जो इराक था उसको अटैक किया गया और एक झूठी इंटेलिजेंस के उस पर बेस पे कि जी सदाम हुसैन के पास ऐसे हथियार हैं जिससे वो 45 मिनट के अंदर इसराइल को तबाह कर सकता है या कला कमा कर सकता है, वो निरा झूठ था। वो चिलकॉट रिपोर्ट आ गई है, बेतहाशा रिपोर्टें आ गई हैं, कोलिन पॉल साहब सर पकड़ के बैठ गए कि जी मुझे झूठी इंफॉर्मेशन दी गई थी, मगर ये सब शामिल थे। ये एक मुल्क को तबाह करना चाहते थे, वहाँ चूंकि तेल था तो उसके बेसिस पर उन्होंने अटैक किया, झूठी इंटेलिजेंस बिल्कुल। सीरिया के बारे में भी उन्होंने कहा केमिकल वेपन हैं तुम्हारे पास, कैमरा सीरिया के पास थे केमिकल वेपन, उन्होंने कहा तुम अगर नहीं अपने केमिकल वेपन से दस्तबरदार हो गए तो हम तुम पे अटैक कर देंगे। ये 6 सितंबर ओबामा साहब ने, मैं उस वक्त मौजूद था डीसी में, मैंने खुद देखा पेंटागन के सामने, इट वॉज अ गुड फ्राइडे और वो भरा हुआ था, काम काज हो रहा था। मैंने कहा लो एक और मुसलमान मुल्क की शामत आई। उन्होंने कहा जी आप अगर नहीं अपने केमिकल वेपन्स को गिव अप करेंगे या CWC पे नहीं साइन करेंगे तो हम आपको मिसाइल से अटैक कर देंगे। दूसरा मुल्क, तीसरा मुल्क अगर आप समझें तो वो लीबिया है। लीबिया को पहले तो इन्होंने खुद ही इनक्रेज किया तमाम वेस्टर्न कंट्रीज ने, इंक्लूडिंग UK और USA के ही, तुम अपने जो भी तुम्हारा प्रोग्राम है, ऐसी कोई खास प्रोग्राम नहीं था। वो कहते थे कि पाकिस्तान ने हमें न्यूक्लियर वेपन, हमें वो क्या कहते हैं ये सेंट्रीफ्यूजेस की कोई डायग्राम्स वगैरह दी हैं, पाकिस्तान का नाम लोग बदनाम करने बहुत तेज़ हैं, तो तुम कर दो तो हम तुम्हारे साथ तजारत जो है बहाल कर देंगे। उसने कर दिया, उस गरीब का उन्होंने मार मार के उसके मुल्क पे, नेटो ने बाकायदा फिजिकली कन्वेंशनल अटैक्स किए और उसको इसका कदाफी के साथ इतना बुरा सलूक किया कि उस बेवकूफ़ आदमी को एक पाइप से निकाल के उन्होंने लोगों से मरवा दिया। और अब लीबिया जो है एक फ्रैक्चर्ड मुल्क है, इट इज़ नॉट ओनली, इट्स नो मोर अ कंसोलिडेटेड कंट्री। इसमें एक से ज़्यादा हुकूमतें हैं जो हुकूमत कर रही हैं, एक UN रिकग्नाइज है, एक नॉट UN रिकग्नाइज है, कुछ को रशिया सपोर्ट कर रहा है, कुछ को इजिप्ट सपोर्ट कर रहा है, कुछ को तुर्की सपोर्ट कर रहा है, तो एक अजीब किस्म की खिचड़ी मची हुई है। तो ये उस मुल्क का हाल किया जिसके पास न्यूक्लियर हथियार नहीं थे या जिनसे वो कतराया लेने से। अच्छा, आजकल जो सबसे इम्पॉर्टेंट चीज़ हो रही है वो ईरानियन मॉडल है। इनके साथ आप हम सबको पता है कि ईरान के साथ इंगेजमेंट की ओबामा दौर में P5+1 जर्मनी को शामिल करके, उन्होंने कहा जॉइंट कॉम्प्रेंसिव प्लान ऑफ एक्शन है और उसके तहत उन्होंने इनका ब्रेकआउट टाइम जो है वो 10 से 15 साल पीछे कर दिया। उन्होंने कहा जी आप इतने सेंट्रीफ्यूजेस से इतना फिसाइल मटेरियल बनाएंगे जिसकी इनरिचमेंट जो है वो 3% से ज़्यादा नहीं होगी और आप जो है ना इनको काबू में रखने के, वो मान गए। उन्होंने कहा जी हम आपको आपके जो है वो इकोनॉमिक सेंक्शन आप पे लिफ्ट कर देंगे, आपके जो एसेट्स हैं मुख्तलिफ ममालिक में वो उनको अनफ्रीज कर देंगे, जो आपको टेक्नोलॉजी चाहिए बहुत पीछे रह गए ये उसमें एयरक्राफ्ट इंडस्ट्री में और उन मुख्तलिफ जगहों पर वो आपको दे देंगे। वो ट्रंप साहब ने आके उससे वो निकल गया, उन्होंने कहा नहीं जी ये तो गलत फैसला किया था उसने, तो ये हम मैं तो उसको नहीं मानता, यूनिलैटरली विड्रॉ कर गया। उसके अलावा हमें ये भी पता है कि ईरान में इन्होंने साइबर अटैक्स किए, स्टक्सनेक्स के अटैक किए जिसमें उनके सेंट्रीफ्यूजेस को नुकसान पहुँचाया गया, और अभी हालिया नतांस पे एक आउटेज हुआ है जिसमें वो एक इनका अपना आदमी था रजा करीमी गालिब ने उसका नाम था जो भाग भी गया, इनसाइडर अटैक था। स्टक्सनेट के बारे में भी कहते हैं कि वो भी इनसाइडर अटैक था, किसी ने एक जो स्टिक थी जो जिसमें वायरस था उसको किसी ने अंदर से जाके सेंट्रीफ्यूज में लगा दिया था, तो इतनी तेज़ रफ्तार से उन्होंने सेंट्रीफ्यूज में घूमना शुरू कर दिया कि वो पागल हो गए आप समझ लें और वो क्रैश कर लें। और तीसरी चीज़ जो बड़ी वाज़ तौर पर की जा रही है वो एक कत्ल कर रहे हैं उनके कमांडर्स को भी, कासिम सुलेमानी को मार दिया उन्होंने, इराक में था वहाँ, और दूसरा उन्होंने अभी हाल में मोहसिन फखरीज़ादे का भी कत्ल किया। तो ये मुख्तलिफ तरीक़े हैं उनके एटमी प्रोग्राम को रोकने के लिए, तो इसमें हम सब के लिए लेसन्स हैं। ये हमारे साथ नहीं हो रहा मगर हमारे साथ हो सकता है। फिर जो नॉर्थ कोरियन मॉडल है, इनके साथ भी पहले इनकी बातचीत हुई, एग्रीड फ्रेमवर्क हुआ, इसमें भी मुख्तलिफ ममालिक शामिल थे, बातचीत हो गई, इनको कहा कि नॉर्थ कोरिया को हम आपको हाई डीजल ऑयल देंगे, आप योंगबियोन में जो अपना एटमी रिएक्टर्स को बंद कर दें, वो मान गए, मगर बाद में ये भी चला नहीं। और नॉर्थ कोरिया ने ये मुनासिब समझा कि NPT से निकल आए क्योंकि उनके तई उनकी सिक्योरिटी इंटरेस्ट जो थे उनको नुकसान पहुंच रहा था NPT में रहने में, तो उन्होंने जो अप्रोप्रिएट क्लॉज था वो इस्तेमाल किया एंड दे वॉक आउट ऑफ इट साइटिंग सिक्योरिटी कंसर्न्स। अच्छा, अभी जो वहाँ हो रहा है कोरियन पेनिनसुला में, वहाँ वॉर गेम्स होती हैं, ड्रिल्स होती हैं डराने धमकाने के लिए, ये साउथ कोरिया भी करता है, जापान भी करता है, अमेरिका भी सारे मिलजुल के करते हैं, और जो है उसकी रिएक्शन के तौर पे नॉर्थ कोरिया जो है वो अपना जो मिसाइल्स के डेमोन्स्ट्रेशंस करता है। तो ये एक किस्म की वहाँ चल रहा है मॉडल, मगर नॉर्थ कोरिया जो है वो अपने उस पर डटा हुआ, उसका कुछ बिगाड़ नहीं सकते क्योंकि एक तो उसने न्यूक्लियर कैपेबिलिटी हासिल कर ली है और उसकी पुष्ट बनाई चीन कर रहा है। तो ये चंद बातें थी जो मैं आपसे शेयर करना चाहता था और मुझे बड़ी खुशी होगी अगर इस पर मुझसे कोई आप सवाल जवाब करना चाहें। शुक्रिया बहुत बहुत, थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर लिसनिंग टू मी, थैंक यू फॉर योर पेशेंस।
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, shall we move to question answer session?
Yes, please.
Yes, sir. The first question is addressed to Dr. Adil Sultan. The question is by Ms. Saba Hanif. She's from NDU. What will be the implication for Pakistan if India joins NSG? Rather, how complex the situation for Pakistan will become as NSG entry decisions are binding?
Okay. Thank you, Sabha, for asking this question. Before I respond, I must also appreciate the patience of all the participants during Ramzan. They are listening to history lessons, which is anyway a difficult thing under normal days. So in Ramzan, it becomes more taxing also. Sabha, your question about NSG implications for Pakistan. If India is given a membership of the NSG, first of all, NSG is not a legal regime. It is an informal arrangement, but definitely the countries that participate, they have political obligations, and the country decisions, whatever the decision make, they are based on consensus. So if India is made a permanent member of the NSG, so it will, in a way, legitimize India's nuclear status of a nuclear weapon state outside the NPT, as I also mentioned in my remarks. Because India, under the NSG exemption of 2008, India is already qualified to trade in nuclear and dual sensitive technologies with the rest of the NSG members. So there's not going to be any additional technical benefit, but there is going to be a political benefit to to India, that India would be seen as a responsible country and brought into mainstream non-proliferation regime. Its status of a nuclear weapon states would be given legitimacy, and the implications would be that Pakistan probably would emerge as the only country technically ineligible for nuclear trade with the NSG countries, apart from Israel. Israel doesn't need any NSG membership or exemption. It gets whatever it wants from the United States or the Western sources. So that is going to be political implications for NSG. But as you said, the second part of your question, the NSG decisions, yes, they do take decisions by consensus, but these decisions are not binding because NSG is not a legal regime. In the end, the NSG members can decide for themselves whether they want to trade with any country or not, but generally they do avoid because they don't want to go against the consensus. And one example that we saw that soon after India, India was given an exemption, even before exemption, sorry, my apology, even before the consensus decision was made, India negotiated the safeguards with the IAEA. They supplied fuel to India, citing safety considerations, so they started supplying. So any of the NSG member can trade with any of the non-NSG members, but generally they remain reluctant, and that's the technical and political implications. But if you do have some time, Chair Bano, so give me some time, because some of the comments that Dr. Togal said, I just want to elaborate on that, regional arrangements or India-Pakistan bilateral treaties and things like that. So whenever you have time, so I'll be happy to respond to that.
You can do right now.
Okay. You can, sir. Grateful.
Dr. Togal rightly said that like the Cold War, we do not have any bilateral agreements between India and United States, but we have to understand that before these two countries became nuclear weapon state, or before we started seriously pursuing our nuclear weapons program, we had offered several arrangements, bilateral arrangements to India. That included bilateral test ban treaty in 1987, signing NPT jointly, accepting comprehensive safeguards, or declaring South Asia nuclear weapon free zones in South Asia. Absolutely, he's correct. There are no such agreements on the pattern of what we had between Soviet Union and the United States. But by offering these agreements, we also see the intent or the diverse security interests of both the countries, which also substantiate my earlier points that India always wanted to keep its options open. It wanted to be seen as a major power. So it didn't want to engage with Pakistan on these agreements. So these agreements are only possible if there are convergence of interest or convergence of approach. However, we didn't have these major agreements, but we did have some CBMs, like we agreed not to attack each other's nuclear facilities. We do have a bilateral agreement of missile notification, where both sides, they notify each other of any missile launch. Although lately India had been violating, because some of the missile tests that it carried out from submarines, it said, our agreement is about surface to surface and submarine is not surface, and hence we do not notify, did not notify to Pakistan. So that was in technical violation of that bilateral agreement. So finally, on nuclear deterrence, there are some sentiments I've seen on social media also, people talking about that, look at COVID and Corona, why do we need nuclear weapons? I think we have to be very, very clear. As Dr. Zafar also said, nuclear weapons are not a panacea for all the problems. Now, these challenges have emerged, non-traditional security. For now, if we start to say that we do not need nuclear weapons and hence these non-traditional security threats are more important, what happens once this threat is over? Do we think that all the countries will be living peacefully and everything will be normal? I think that the real polity, which drives international relations, which gives, and we learn from the history, during Cold War, Soviet Union, United States, they developed several technologies, they went to space, but they continue to maintain their nuclear capability, because nuclear capability or nuclear deterrence has a specific purpose. And I think we should also understand that we cannot just diminish its utility, because non-traditional security threats are likely to be more dominant in South Asia. Hence, we don't need to put focus on nuclear deterrence. Finally, even if all the resources are diverted towards non-traditional security threats, do we have guarantee that we will be able to maintain or manage all the future threats? Not necessarily, because that is a problem of management, not necessarily a prioritizing of the resources. But I'll be happy to listen to critique and any follow-up questions. Thank you, sir.
Shirvano, can I add a word?
Sure, sir, sure.
Yep, I would like to point out that there are two agreements between India and Pakistan, and they're full-fledged agreements. One is, Adil has just mentioned, no attack on each other's nuclear facilities. It's not just a CBM, it's a full-fledged agreement, which every year India and Pakistan exchange nuclear facilities list, and they are not supposed to attack each other's nuclear facilities other than what is a nuclear weapon program. And second is an accident measures agreement, which the additional secretaries of the two countries signed in 2007. Accident measures are kind of an agreement which was, I think, on our behalf. It was signed by Tariq Usman Haider, and he was additional secretary in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And it was signed with India at that time in New Delhi. So there are two clear agreements between India and Pakistan. To say that there is no direct agreement between India and Pakistan is not correct. So thank you very much. Thank you, Shirvano. You go ahead.
आपने सही बात की कि जी कोई एग्रीमेंट्स हैं, मगर ये कॉन्फिडेंस बिल्डिंग मेजर्स हैं, दे आर नॉट एग्रीमेंट्स.
सो द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज बाय एंबेसडर फौजिया नसरीन. हर क्वेश्चन इज नॉट स्पेसिफाइड टू एनी पैनलिस्ट, एनी ऑफ द पैनलिस्ट कैन आंसर. व्हाट विल बी द फ्यूचर ऑफ एनपीटी गिवन द डोमिनेंट रोल ऑफ डिसरप्टिव टेक्नोलॉजीज इन साउथ एशिया?
ज़फर, कैन यू आंसर दिस क्वेश्चन?
यस. Future of NPT, because NPT is one of the longest treaty, you know, between the states. You know, it's got now more than 190 plus countries, you know, right? So the future is there, but it is a weak treaty because there are a lot of issues with it. You know, one of the points that you mentioned was that it recognizes only five states between have and haves not, you know, back January 1st, 1967, you know, before it was enforced and open to many other countries. So that's one of the biggest issue. The rest of the countries in accordance with the NPT does not recognize, you know, the other points that they would go one day for nuclear disarmament, you know, so nuclear disarmament is not happening, even though there have been a lot of treaties on arms control between the nuclear weapons, particularly between the Soviet Union and the US during the Cold War time. But in any case, the existence of NPT is very important, you know. It has contained what was predicted once by John F. Kennedy in the US, that there would be more than two dozen nuclear weapon states, you know. But that is not happening, you know. So we have only nine nuclear weapon states at the moment, you know. Five of them are recognized, the rest in accordance with the NPT are not. With reference to emerging technologies, I think the existence or importance, significance of the NPT is very important, you know, because in the future, it will be looking into these disruptive technologies to pursue states, to have some sort of control regime on these disruptive technologies, let's say between the US and the Soviet Union, starting from there, or starting from the established nuclear weapon states. So I think the future is there for the NPT if it is to bring all the amendments and changes into it. Thank you so much. I hope this answers the questions.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question is addressed to Dr. Rabe Akhtar. The question is addressed by asked by Dr. Tariq Rauf. How would you compare the U.S. blind eye towards India-Pakistan with that towards Israel's nuclear program from the 1960s till the present?
All right, thank you so much for this question, Dr. Tariq Rauf. You know, as we all know, Israel doesn't have a bomb. So, you know, in all, you know, realistic purposes, this question would not hold in any, you know, court of law. But the list of nations that has sold technology, nuclear technology to Israel, including both the materials and expertise to make nuclear weapons, they collectively have turned a blind eye to the theft itself. And these countries are one of the strongest supporters of non-proliferation today. And they all, it's not just one country, it is US, it is France, it is Germany, it is Britain, and it is Norway. And I would urge everybody to read you know, an article that came out in The Guardian, The Truth About Israel's Secret Nuclear Arsenal, and as well as many other, you know, Wilson Center has this whole huge cache of, you know, declassified materials, which does point to Israel's possession of nuclear weapons. So the way I rationalize all of this is that there is this organized hypocrisy that surrounds the entire debate about non-proliferation. And the so-called leaders of the nuclear non-proliferation regime are the ones who are the gatekeepers. And if today they want to sanction Israel for its nuclear proliferation behavior, you know, all the facts will be out here. But as long as this organized hypocrisy remains, we will not see Israel being condemned for the possession of nuclear weapons. And that is the irony that those who point fingers towards Pakistan, for example, or India, you know, they are the ones who are gatekeeping what information gets out, who gets to be blamed, who gets to be sanctioned. And there is not one yardstick with respect to that. So while Pakistan would like to say that, yes, Israel possesses nuclear weapons, those the powers that be who have the power to sanction a country like Israel, you know, are okay with the bomb in the basement and the ambiguity approach that Israel has. Thank you.
Sherbano.
Thank you so much. The next question is by.
Can we ask Tarek Rauf that if he wants to make a statement, he can make a brief statement?
Sure, sir. I've conveyed to Mushtaba to promote him on the panelist.
Yeah. Can we ask Tarek? Tarek, can you listen to us?
Yes, thank you.
Would you like to make a brief statement?
This was a very interesting panel, and thank you to all the panelists. I apologize to Rabia for asking her a trick question, although I would disagree with her very first statement. If you remember in the meeting between President Johnson and Golda Meir, they already reached a secret understanding that the U.S. would turn a firm blind eye to what Israel was up to. And during the Kennedy administration, when the U.S. sent inspectors to Dimona, they also conveniently turned a blind eye, and the Israelis led them around in circles when they gave them access to Dimona. So it's a very well-known secret what Israel has, and you very correctly outlined all the countries that provided material, technology, and other elements of Israel's nuclear program. And you're also absolutely correct that in all international forums, at the IAEA, in the NPT, whenever the discussion turns to Israel, mainly by the Arab states, it's very quickly shut down. And there is a very strong tendency to focus on, quote unquote, the proliferation challenges of today, like Iran and North Korea. And unfortunately, Pakistan is also lumped into that category, while, to use your term, turning a blind eye to India. Israel is still very much protected. And it is also a big hypocrisy that Israel has been attacking Iranian nuclear facilities, including the latest one. And this is contrary to resolutions and decisions at the IAEA on attacking nuclear facilities. In addition, they have assassinated 5 nuclear scientists in Iran over the past 7 years. And again, one could characterize this as state terrorism, but which is the country that is accused of state terrorism is not them, but Iran. So this is an unfortunate situation. And if people, academics, talk about it, they generally tend to be shut out. And different types of accusations are made against them. So thank you very much. And I will go back to being invisible.
Thank you. Thank you. Kirbano, you can continue.
The next question is by Sayed Ali Zia Jafri from University of Lahore. His question is addressed to Dr. Zafar Khan. In his 1975 classic, Escalation and Nuclear Option, Dr. Brody cautioned us not to conflate small border violations with deterrence failures. On what basis do you think deterrence, both conventional and nuclear, failed recently?
Well, see, conventional deterrence has failed in the past, you know, right? So there are a lot of examples, you know, right? This is what I've referred in my presentation. One of the books of John Mersheimer on conventional deterrence probably is published this from Cornell or University Press in 1985. So he mentions that there are a lot of cases on the conventional deterrence that have failed. Perhaps you know one or two. You know, luckily that worked out. You know, but in the rest of the episode, you know, conventional deterrence has pretty much failed. On the nuclear deterrence, I think nuclear deterrence has not failed yet. You know, even though there are several crises during the Cold War, you know, if you just go through the pages of the history, you know, and all these unclassified documents, you know, Dr. Rabi Akhtar must have gone through it, you know. So nuclear deterrence is facing or has faced a lot of challenges or crises, you know, over the period of time, but it has luckily has not failed it yet. It has prevented, you know, major crises or major wars or bigger wars, you know, between particularly between the nuclear weapon states. So it has got a volume. It has got a significance. It probably would have that significance in the future as well. You know, even though we probably go and acquire these new technologies and emerging technologies, nuclear deterrence would have its own significance, its own standing in the realm of international politics, or in the realm of international nuclear politics.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question is by Haris Bilal Malik. He's a research associate at the SVI. His question is addressed to Dr. Thur Al-Yameen. Given the current discriminatory political and diplomatic trends of global non-proliferation regime, what could be Pakistan's future course of action? Given the current discriminatory political and diplomatic trends of global non-proliferation regime, what could be Pakistan's future course of action?
देखिए पाकिस्तान के कोर्स ऑफ एक्शन बड़े क्लियर हैं. हमने एनपीटी नहीं साइन करना, हम नहीं करेंगे जब तक इंडिया नहीं करेगा, ठीक है. हमने सीटीबीटी के बारे में भी यही शर्त लगाई है कि इंडिया साइन करेगा तो हम भी कर देंगे. एफएमसीटी के बारे में हम कहते हैं कि जी जो फिसल मटेरियल स्टॉक्स इंडिया के हैं वो उसका भी शुमार होना चाहिए, वो बात वहीं के वहीं रुकी हुई है. तो देखिए जो जहाँ तक साउथ एशिया का ताल्लुक है, स्टांसेस जो हैं बड़े हार्ड हैं, रिजिड हैं, हर एक को पता है क्या करना है क्या नहीं करना. सिर्फ जो फ़र्क है पाकिस्तान ये साउथ एशिया में वो ये कि पाकिस्तान के पास भी न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं, इंडिया के पास भी न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं और चीन तो के पास तो बहुत अच्छे से न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं. तो पाकिस्तान की जो पॉलिसीज़ हैं उसमें कोई चेंज नहीं आने वाली आगे भी. मैं नहीं देखता कि पाकिस्तान की कोई चेंज आएगी और पाकिस्तान पर कोई सख्ती ज़बरदस्ती कर नहीं सकता क्योंकि पाकिस्तान के पास न्यूक्लियर डिटरेंस है. देखिए ना, सबसे बड़ी बात यह है कि जो लीबिया का हशर किया गया या जो ईरान के साथ हो रहा है या जो एक हद तक कोशिश की गई नॉर्थ कोरिया के साथ करने की, वो इसलिए हुआ कि उनके पास उस वक्त तक न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स नहीं थे. नॉर्थ कोरिया के पास न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स आ गए इसलिए नॉर्थ कोरिया का बाल बीका नहीं कर सकते. तो पाकिस्तान के बारे में रेस्ट अश्योर्ड, आपके पास न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स हैं, न्यूक्लियर डिटरेंस हैं, इसलिए आपका स्टांस जो है वो बड़ा क्लियर कट है. इम्पॉर्टेंट बात यह है कि आप अपने सेफ्टी और सिक्योरिटी ना सिर्फ अपने न्यूक्लियर वेपन्स की करें, आप अपने न्यूक्लियर इंस्टॉलेशंस की भी करें. ये चीज़ें जो हम हैं और जो नई उभरती हुई टेक्नोलॉजीज हैं उसका सदभाव करने के लिए आपके पास स्ट्रेटजीज होनी चाहिए. शुक्रिया बहुत बहुत.
थैंक यू सो मच सर. द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज बाय फरोख अंसर. ही इज अ स्टूडेंट ऑफ कायदे आज़म यूनिवर्सिटी. हिज क्वेश्चन इज एड्रेस्ड टू डॉक्टर जफर खान. ही हैज आस्क्ड डॉक्टर जफर टू काइंडली कमेंट ऑन द प्रॉस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ इंडिया पाकिस्तान डिटेरेंस स्टेबिलिटी इन द बैकड्रॉप ऑफ इंडियाज परसिस्टेंट डॉक्ट्रिनल मैन्यूवरिंग मिलिट्री टेक्नोलॉजिकल एडवांसमेंट्स एंड प्रीएम्प्टिव स्ट्रेटजीज टू लॉन्च अ लिमिटेड मिलिट्री ऑफेंसिव लाइक बालाकोट.
वेल आई थिंक दिस इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग क्वेश्चन, यू नो. And we have experienced all these crises, you know, since the acquisition, since the arrival of nuclear weapons, you know, since the arrival of the capabilities of nuclear weapons in the 1980s, until Pakistan acquired that capability, tested that capability in 1998, in response to India's nuclear weapons test, you know, in 1998 and then 1974, which we consider that was a nuclear weapons nuclear weapon test. The crisis, as I told, as I mentioned in my book as well, the new book, India's Evolving Nuclear Posture, India Evolving Deterrent Force Posturing, Escalation Dominance, you know. So India will have all these imperative because of the new technology, because of the technology, the kind of technology that India is acquiring from all these countries, you know, particularly the US, France, and including Israel. It will have the incentive, will have the confidence, you know, to go for escalation dominance and preemptive strike, you know, against, say, Pakistan or perhaps China as well, you know, because at once they have mentioned, you know, that we can wage a war at two fronts, you know, which probably may be critiqued, you know, how India could do that. India is not a US or not a Soviet Union, you know. It has got its own limitation, you know, it's got its own. It is yet to develop that capacity to wage two-front war, you know, particularly with the nuclear weapon state, you know, such as Pakistan and China. So India would be very much careful, you know, not to go for such a mistaken approach towards waging even the limited war, you know, against any of the nuclear weapon state, you know, in its vicinity, because that will have the fear of escalation, you know, to a bigger level, you know, which perhaps nobody wants to begin with.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question is by Mr. Adil Kazmi. He has not mentioned his affiliation. His question is, since in South Asia, the rival diets have divergent views on nuclear history and tangent perspective on deterrence and the way it has functioned in various crises up to Pulwama 2019. In this acrimonious backdrop, do we have any hope to see these two nuclear rivals entering into any serious bilateral agreements on further on further nuclear non-proliferation and fruitful evading the trap of arms race in the region?
He's asked any particular speaker to answer.
So he has not specified any of the panelists can answer the question.
Can we request Dr. Rabia and Hazrat Sultan both to share their response on this? Dr.
Sure,
Rabia,
sir.
What are you trying to?
Gigi, sure, sir. Thank you. I'll just be brief. Adil, you know, when arms control was happening between US and Russia, they moved in that direction when they had achieved certain parity. And it was both parity at the strategic level, it was parity in the numbers, in the type of delivery vehicles they had. And that is what pushed both countries, to realize as to, you know, what has happened over a period of years. And that parity led to arms control framework and new types of, you know, mechanisms to come into place so that they stop at that numbers that they had. With India and Pakistan, you know, we do not have that kind of parity. And unfortunately, until and unless that parity is achieved, I do not foresee an arms control framework between India and Pakistan to come into place, because India builds on and modernizes this program, you know, and sells it to the world that it's because of China. And China is in this game of, not in the game of numbers, but in the case of modernizing its arsenal and delivery means and getting to more disruptive technologies, inducting them in its program because of US. So as long as we have this strategic chain, which is, you know, unidirectional, I do not see an arms control framework happening. But Pakistan maintains that it is not in an arms race with India, and it just wants to maintain credibility of its deterrence. And whatever it takes to maintain that credibility of that deterrence, that's what Pakistan continues to pursue. Thank you.
Do you want me to add on to this, Ms. Shehbano?
If you want to, please go ahead.
Yeah, I think generally I agree with Dr. Rabia. I also see this India, Pakistan, and India, China as two asymmetric dyads, and that has emerged more recently. So what has happened, the factors that Rabia mentioned, in addition to that, the India-US strategic partnership and the way India is being projected to play its role in Asia, Indo-Pacific, and in the Quad, India has become more dismissive. It has no incentive to engage with Pakistan because the major powers, especially the United States, they want India to emerge as a rival to China. So unless there is commonality of interest, there's not likely to be any arms control arrangement between the two countries. Before India-US strategic partnership, or when India and Pakistan were talking, there were some common grounds where both the sides agreed to certain agreements. We had these agreements. But as the things are evolving, the more India is propped up to play a major role against China, it will have reduced incentive to engage with Pakistan. That is ironic, and that's what's troubling. And that is why we continue to tell to the major powers that their actions are creating instability in the region, reducing incentive for India to engage in bilateral measures. Otherwise, arms control is in the benefit of India and Pakistan both for the regional stability.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question.
How many questions we have more?
Sir, we still have a long list of questions.
Can we have last two questions?
Fine, sir. The next question is by Tayyeba Nisar Khan. She's a news anchor at PTV World. Her question is addressed to Dr. Rabia Akhtar. Did US show a preferential treatment toward India, especially under Carter administration before 123 agreement, where they de facto accepted India as a budding regional power and lacks their sanctions? How did it affect Pakistan at that time?
All right, thank you so much, Taiba. So, you know, with respect to India, India and US had an agreement which was signed in 1963. And according to that agreement, US had agreed to supply low enriched uranium fuel for the Indian nuclear reactors at Tarapur. And that the life of that agreement was for 30 years, which was actually the life of the reactors itself. So the agreement required India maintain safeguards on the US supplied fuel, it not undertake reprocessing without US consent, and not use enriched uranium for nuclear explosives. Even though India conducted a peaceful nuclear explosion in 1974, it was still considered a non-nuclear weapon state according to the NPT and the NNPA of 78. And it required that all non-nuclear weapon states place their nuclear facilities under full scope safe international safeguards in order for, you know, the US NRC to license the applications for export of nuclear fuels, reactors, as well as sensitive nuclear technologies. And this is what Pakistan, you know, had an issue with. That is what the controversy with the Carter administration was, because although there was domestic pressure on him not to send the shipments, but there was, he took refuge in that 1963 agreement that they had. I hope that briefly answers your question.
Thank you so much, Sina. The last question is by Mr. Sufianullah. He's a senior research fellow at CIS. His question is, for the benefit of all, can any of the panelists briefly explain the difference between agreement and a confidence building measure? Plus, what is the legal significance of a CBMs?
May I request Adil Sultan to kindly
give yes, sir. Yeah, we kept it pending towards the end. With all due respect, I think Dr. Togral also is not disagreeing with this. It's the way you see it. Once we, all the agreements or the CBMs, they are intended to build confidence amongst rival countries. So once we talk in terms of the nomenclature, I think the agreement on missile notification is an agreement. Agreement to not attack on each other facility is an agreement. These are agreements between India and Pakistan. Why we tend to, probably the confusion was, we didn't have any arms reduction agreement unlike the Soviet and United States. And naturally, between Soviet Union and United States, there was convergence of interest that we don't need to build more, let's reduce, because it served their interests. And there was understanding. So that is how they agreed to those kind of agreements. Between India and Pakistan, we are nowhere closer to the Cold War model. So we should not be looking at that we will be replicating all those agreements of arms reduction what Soviet Union, United States did or other powers did. We have our peculiar environment. Our interests are more about bringing stability in this region. And to bring that stability, the ideas that came up from both from India and Pakistan. So these were some of the common grounds where we could develop that kind of understanding, but these are agreements. So agreements to enhance confidence. And this was as a process that was started from the CBM process that culminated into those agreements. And these are legally binding agreements between India and Pakistan. So that is it. So if you have just time, I'll just want to comment on some of the questions that were asked, if you allow, sir, if you have time.
We are running short of time, and because the proceeding is to be followed by a namaz, what I can say is that we can request all the panelists that if you have something to conclude, we can give you a minute or so to kindly conclude those remarks. So we can request all the panelists one by one. We can start with you, and then.
Okay, sir. Sir, thank you. There was a question about future of NPT. NPT, we need to take into consideration, it was about non-proliferation and disarmament, not related to emerging technologies. The biggest challenge to NPT is from Treaty on Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, which has emerged as a parallel treaty that is undermining NPTs. But NPT for now remains strong. There was also a question about future options on arms control. One liner, there are no unilateral concessions by any country, and Pakistan should also not consider any unilateral concession. This is real politics, and we should preserve it. Finally, Dr. Zafar just mentioned about the failure of conventional deterrence. I think from Pulwama crisis, what a lesson that we can take, that conventional deterrence was re-established. There was a perception that Pakistan probably cannot take on India conventionally, but by responding, I think that message is now very clear that conventional deterrence is also credible between India and Pakistan, but it's a matter of debate. Thank you very much.
Dr. Rabia, would you like to say something?
So very briefly, I personally don't think that CBMs are going to stand their ground in times of a crisis or a conflict that goes up to war. No country that signs agreements or CBMs, can be held accountable. I know they are legally, what is the legal binding of these agreements? they're bilaterally enforced. And if one party, one party, bows out, then, there goes the, agreement itself. CBM simply pave way and make ground for agreements to be signed. And these are two different things. One question was posed about India calling Pakistan's nuclear bluff. My only submission on that is that the literature does a lot of disservice to Pakistan, because the literature on Pakistan's nuclear behavior, which has been generated in the West, looks at Pakistan as a weaker state party, which is going to go nuclear early on in the conflict. Because the literature establishes that Pakistan cannot fight and win a conventional war against India. And it is due to that literature that India has gained false confidence, arrogance, and borders on hubris when it tests Pakistan's resolve. I think Pulwama and Balakot has set that record straight. And that's all that I would like to say. Thank you.
Dr. Zafar, would you like to say something?
I think all these interesting points said by the panelist, but then things are debatable, right? Highly debatable, when it comes to convention and nuclear and new technologies and the effects on deterrence and strategic stability, and then the future of NPT now, and FMCT, the cartel group, NSG, including many others. But what is important is the history, and what in history, what lessons we learn from history, in terms of nuclear posturing and modernization, forced modernization, and the arrival of new technologies, and the impact of these, the implication of these technologies on forced posture, on modernization, and the nuclear policies of the nuclear weapon states. That's important, I think. So we need to consider the history as a tool, as an empirical evidence, to look into the issues, in 10 years, 15 years, 20 years time, what would happen, and how that can be materialized, emitting out of the nuclear history that we have, Cold War and the South Asian nuclear history. Thank you.
Dr. Yameen? Dr. Yameen?
मैं कुछ ज़्यादा बात नहीं करना चाहता, मैं सिर्फ ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि देखिए, हमें अपनी तारीख का पता है कि हमारे साथ क्या हुआ, किसने धोखा दिया, कैसे हुआ, पाकिस्तान वीकर स्टेट है। जो ज़्यादा ज़रूरी बात है वो हमें आगे फ्यूचरिस्टिक देखने, ये जितनी डिस्कशंस होती हैं इसमें ज़्यादातर हम रिपीट कर रहे होते हैं कि भाई फलानी तारीख को क्या हुआ, 1980 की दहाई में क्या हुआ, 1990 की दहाई में क्या हुआ, 2000 में क्या हुआ, अब तो 2019 की तारीख भी पुरानी हो गई, जो बालाकोट पे हमला किया था हिंदुस्तान ने। और बिल्कुल सही डॉक्टर राबिया ने कहा, रिकॉर्ड स्ट्रेट हो गया, कन्वेंशनल हमने उनको जवाब दे दिया और न्यूक्लियर डिटरेंस हमारी बरकरार है। आगे 5 साल में क्या होगा, आगे 10 साल में क्या होगा? देखें, जो खतरे वाली बात है, जो मैं बार बार मुख्तलिफ मौक़ों पर कह चुका हूँ, हमारे कम्युनिकेशन और सेटेलाइट टेक्नोलॉजी में बहुत पीछे रहे, ठीक है। साइबर डिफेंसेस हमारे ज़्यादा स्ट्रॉन्ग होने चाहिए। आपसे एक आपका एटमी हथियार कोई भी नहीं ले सकता, सिर्फ उस सूरत में आपके एटमी हथियार आपसे लिए जाएंगे जब भूखे मर जाएंगे, जब आम सड़कों पर निकलेगी। तो इन तमाम बातों पर गौर फौज की ज़रूरत है। शुक्रिया बहुत बुलाने का, शुक्रिया डॉक्टर जफर इकबाल, शुक्रिया शेरबानो, मैंने बहुत सीखा आज के उसमें, शुक्रिया बहुत बहुत।
so much, sir.
I would like to express my profound gratitude to all the four distinguished panelists, as well as the participants, especially Dr. Tarak Rao, but all other participants for finding time to join us on a discussion or a panel discussion on the South Asian nuclear history. And I'm grateful to all. So I leave it to Sher Bano to kind of wind it up. I would also like to be very thankful to the SVA Research Associates and the SVA technical team, which has made this webinar possible. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you to all the panelists and speakers and Dr. Zafar Iqbal Cheema for joining in the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody.